Welcome, viewers. This is Janisrar Ahmed from Millennium TV USA. I welcome you to my show, News and Views. Viewers, as you know, the Constitution says that the president will be president till January the 20th. Given the ongoing controversy and a debate going on, there seems to be an opinion the president office, White House, it has become a sort of a lame duck office. Or during this time, when the elections are held and the next president takes over, during this time, the president is generally regarded as a lame duck president, because most of his powers of constitutional amendments and making legislation and passing new laws, or taking other significant steps, they are curtailed, and he does not have that much power and authority as he normally has in other periods of his presidency. So, viewers, with that, there seems to be a challenge for President Obama, because he has been taking a number of steps since the elections in order to strengthen his legacy, because he goes back a very long, he has been president for two terms. He came to power in 2008, and he was regarded as a symbol of change and hope, did a lot of for the public and economy. And so after the elections, viewers, President-elect Donald J. Trump, who crafted his entire electoral campaign on the promise that he would repeal and reverse most of the actions and measures taken by President Obama. He held a meeting with President Obama in the White House at President Obama's invitation. The meeting was very cordial, and President Obama assured President-elect Donald J. Trump that the transition would be smooth, and he would see to it that the entire current administration is cooperating with the Trump administration so as to ensure a very smooth transition of power. Viewers, that has been a hallmark of American democracy. It goes back, centuries ago. This has been a tradition. Because this is a requirement of democracy, of American democracy in particular. Because this is regard your loss or your loss is regarded as not something derogatory or negative. You are taught the courage to accept your loss or defeat with grace and with courage. President Obama has displayed a sportsman spirit when he called invited President-elect Donald J. Trump to the White House, and that was appreciated by many people, and was seen as a symbol of President Obama's his personality, how he would be the first one to reach out to his opponents and politicians from across the political divide. So, viewers, while President Obama, he assured President-elect Donald J. Trump that the transition was going to be smooth, at the same time, his administration was taking certain measures to prevent Donald J. Trump from reversing his actions or from undoing his legacy. For instance, there has been tremendous concern on part of the Democratic establishment and even President Obama himself that the Trump administration, it might reverse Obamacare. They have been very worried on that, because President Obama, he even feels a kind of an emotional attachment towards Obamacare, because he thinks that this is directly related to the health and lives of so many Americans. And if the new administration, it is going to reverse that Obamacare, and also known as Affordable Care Health, it would deal a very severe blow to the American public. And he has been directly or like indirectly telling even President-elect Donald Trump not to repeal Obamacare, or but most significant was his meeting last week with the on the Capitol Hill. He met with a range of Democratic lawmakers and legislators and requested them and even urged them that they need to do whatever they can in the in both the House and the Senate to prevent the Republican administration from repealing Obamacare. And that was seen as President Obama's attempt to like save one of the milestones, what he considers to be a milestone of his legacy. And reportedly, the meeting went very well with the Democratic leaders, and they assured the president that they would do whatever they can to uphold this legacy. Viewers, with that, President Obama has also taken certain other measures which he considers as kind of sacrosanct, and that they need to be protected, and that he should take those actions before the new administration takes over. What those actions were? One was he banned oil drilling off the Atlantic coast, and then he established new environmental monuments. Then he protected funding for the Planned Parenthood clinics. And then he also ordered the transfer of detainees from Guantanamo Bay. Also, viewers, he criticized the Israeli settlements and punished Russia for trying to interfere in the American electoral system. Now, viewers, these measures, some of these measures were policy roadblocks intended to discourage the new administration. And then there were other measures that were seen as ideological roadblocks to discourage the new administration from reversing them. Certain the policy roadblocks that he took, of course, they were number one, as I've just told you, is that he banned oil drilling off the coast of Atlantic coast. Now, President Obama has been a very staunch supporter of believing in climate change. He has been going over and doing even the reality and talk shows. He went over and did a show with it was a talk show anchor, and he was an environment activist. So the president went over with him and into sort of he went into the wild with that activist, and that show was regarded as his love and his commitment towards protecting the environment. And all during that show, President Obama was talking about how he felt towards in the environment. And also, viewers, he told the viewers at that time during the show that certain of his steps intended to protect the environment, they, according to the scientists and research data, they have shown practical results, because they have resulted in decline of, for instance, hurricanes, cyclones, and other tropical storms. So that was seen as giving practical results. So if you do certain steps, do take certain measures to protect environment, there is going to be a positive result. And naturally, President was arguing that this policy should proceed into the future. And with his banning of oil drilling off the Atlantic coast, he has made it very difficult for the new administration to reverse that. And likewise, so far as ideological roadblocks are concerned, he criticized, he allowed the passage of a resolution that criticized Israel for making the new settlements, and that has really upset the new administration, the upcoming administration, because that is where the ideological clash comes in. President Obama, during his tenure, he has supported Israel, and he has shown to the Israelis that the U.S. is a staunch supporter and ally of Israel. But so far as where the question of settlements is concerned, President Obama showed his difference, and that difference of opinion was very much vocal, and it was felt all across the political divide. So viewers, it's also, it should be mentioned that President Obama has been taken certain measures to protect the dreamers. The dreamers are the children who were brought to the United States when they were in their early teens and from across the border, but they lived here with their parents or their relatives, and they were brought up and raised in the American way of life. They got the education and they went on to colleges and universities. Now they are a part and parcel of the American life, and they are settled here. But the new administration, the upcoming administration, President-elect Donald J. Trump, he on certain occasions he said that he would repeal DACA, which stands for Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, which is referred to those dreamers. So President-elect Donald J. Trump, he intends to repeal DACA, and at stake is the future of all those children who were brought here when they were in their early teens. How President Obama can protect them, or from you know, from allowing the next administration from sending them back, that is a question that, you know, apparently has no answer. But certain Democratic lawmakers, they have been urging, even within the past couple of days, they have been urging President Obama to take certain legislative measures to give some kind of protection to those children. Now, there are only a few days left, you know, before the new administration will come over and take office. What President Obama can do in those few days, it remains to be seen. And of course, legislation is not that easy. President's powers have already been clipped, because right now the office of the president is considered as a kind of a lame duck. So what President Obama has rightfully done is to raise awareness about the need to let those dreamers live in the United States and live their dream. President Obama has been very respectful towards those dreamers and their right to achieve their dreams in the US. And what he has done recently is to, he has sort of built a political opposition to the idea that they should be sent back. So there is now a viewpoint, a public opinion, and people are now, even there must be certain Republican voters who might be aligning with this viewpoint, that the dreamers should be allowed to live in the US, and that they had no role, they did not do any wrongful act when they were brought over here, because it was somebody else's acts, and not, it was not their fault. So President Obama has built this viewpoint that it is there is a question of legality involved, no doubt. And President-elect Donald J. Trump is like his viewpoint revolves around that question of legality. He has also said that he does not want to do them any harm. But with that viewpoint, there is an opinion that the upcoming administration would, at least so far as the dreamers are concerned, it would try to look into the matter with some concern, and it would try to give them the benefit of the doubt. So we hope that President Obama's legacy, it is, there is always a difference of opinion, and that's what democracy is all about. It is about respecting your opponent's views, and also allowing the public to have their views implemented in different policies and ideas. Viewers, with that, we'll take a short break. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back, viewers. We now move on to our next segment. In this segment, we'll be talking about the Russian cyber warfare activity and its intentions to harm the U.S. Electoral system and democracy. Viewers, the controversy, it has not died down as of now. It is still being debated, and the news is coming in that President Obama, while talking to a major news network, he has said that I did not underestimate Putin, but he also then sort of said that I underestimated the extent to which information in this age of you know, free flowing information and internet, how it can play a very vital role in shaping ideas, and how disinformation can also do the damage. So that was the crux of his interview with the TV channel. President Obama made it very clear that he knew what the intentions of Putin could have been, because during his tenure, President Obama has been very straightforward so far as dealing with Russia has been concerned. When there was some you know, military intervention on part of Russia into Ukraine, the United States of America, it was it went it took a step ahead and took certain measures to discourage Russian attempts at interfering in Ukrainians' affairs. Russia, of course, it violated international norms and values and annexed parts of Ukraine, and that was seen as an attempt by the Obama administration by Russia to spread its sphere of influence. Russia, it was you know, in the region, it was not only Ukraine, but later on it became very obvious that its intervention was not only limited to that area, but also in the Middle East. In Middle East, we saw that Syria became a victim of Russian intervention. The Russians, they played, you know, whatever their game was, it has led to horrific consequences. And it is still yet to be assessed how dangerous those consequences can be. There have been refugees, and there has been a humanitarian crisis. Millions have been displaced, thousands upon thousands have been killed, and at the end of the day, the Assad regime, there is no hope that it would you know, go back or allow the democracy or the electoral process in Russia to take place, because the Assad regime, it has the backing and support from the Kremlin. So this is where President Obama made it very clear that he did not underestimate President Putin, and he knew what he was up to, because he Putin has a whole history of launching or taking the Cold War onto the next phase, and which, as we now have seen, has you know, has been transformed into the cyber warfare, and that is of course it does not have use the conventional methods used in a war, but it can be even more dangerous and more damaging to your system, because if you now, as the Kremlin, it has interfered in the electoral process of the US, it has undermined the faith that the American public have in their democratic process. But of course, President Obama was very wise in retaliating, and he hit back with a set of sanctions. 35 diplomats, they were kicked out, and there were a whole range of other measures that were intended to discourage the Moscow from ever thinking about taking this step again. But viewers, with that, there is a hope that this you know, entire sleazy episode, or however you may call it, it is coming to an end, and that is that bodes very well for everybody involved in the game. It is good for the US democratic process. It will allow the transition to be more smooth. It will allow the people to have their faith in the US politics. And there, at the end of the day, there should be this impression that the politicians, they can display sportsman spirit. Whatever happened, happened, and that was not very good. But of course, the politicians, they can make amends, and they can go forward, and they can do something for the country. Now, the viewers, a recent report has come up, and it says that it focuses on Republican voters. the areas and the states where a large majority of the people voted for the Republicans, President-elect Donald J. Trump. And those voters, you know, some of the people, they were interviewed and they said, well, they did not mind the fact that anybody hacked into the DNC's computer systems and tried to meddle into the process. Now, that was one view. But there were others who said that they were very much concerned that why this happened. And but overall, there was tremendous support for President Donald Trump, President-elect Donald J. Trump. That support, it has not withered down. It has not died down. The people who actually voted for Mr. Trump, they still are saying that they still regard him in high esteem, and of course that was something that he did not have any role to play in. And of course, at the end of the day, the voter machines, voting machines, they were not tampered with. So again, this is a democracy, and people have their views. Some of the people they say they are perfectly okay. The image of their leader, it has not been tarnished. While the others, they have expressed their views. But life moves on, life goes on. And there is now hope that with this controversy coming to an end, a new chapter will evolve where the US, the new administration, it would you know, try to fulfill its promises made to the public, and it would try to usher in a new era of growth, economic success, and hope for a better future. Viewers, with that, we'll take a very short break. Don't go anywhere. We'll be just right back. Welcome back, viewers. Another big news making the rounds and making the headlines all over, all across the United States is that the Senate seems all set to begin hearings for the cabinet nominations. And but the thing is that these hearings, they are going to start without all the requisite background checks and a report from the Government Ethics Office that is required before the Senate can confirm or can begin the hearings for the cabinet nominations. Now, viewers, this has caused quite a heat, quite a friction between the Democrats and Republicans. And now it seems to be heading towards a kind of some kind of an ideological clash, perhaps, between the Democrats and the Republicans. Viewers, there is a concern that if all these nominations, they are very, very crucial to running the affairs of the country. Because at the end of the day, there is a view that you are running a government which has the world's most strongest you know, economy, and it is the globe's biggest superpower. And so these nominations, they cannot be done without those requisite background checks. There is also an issue of conflict of interest involved, because most of the nominations signed by President-elect Donald J. Trump, they happen to be quite rich individuals. They are millionaires, and some of them are even billionaires. So naturally, the Democrats, they have been expressing the concern that it should be ensured that there is virtually no conflict of interest involved before the Senate holds the hearings and confirms these nominations. Viewers, it seems that, you know, debate is going towards a very kind of a logical conclusion, and the hearings would begin on Tuesday, and it would go on into Wednesday and later of this week. But viewers, there is also a view that the Office of the Government Ethics itself, the director of the department, he has himself expressed the concern that his department is under tremendous pressure to rush through the whole process, and that cannot be done because there is a time frame that is required before all the checks can be ensured and all the reports. There is also, viewers, a report, clearance report from the FBI that is required before those nominations can be confirmed. So when you know there are certain individuals that are going to become cabinet nominations and you know hold certain one of the most important and crucial positions in the administration, the view is that the entire you know process of the law that should be followed. Now president-elect's nominations, they have been, as I've told you, some of them are happen to be quite rich individuals, some of them happen to be running big corporations and companies, so hence these concerns from the Democrats. Viewers, as you know, the one of the very crucial nominations happens to be Mr. Jeff Sessions. He is being nominated to take the slot of Attorney General, and as Attorney General, you know, you are at the sort of at the masthead of running the entire affairs of the judicial branch and other important decision making processes. Then viewers, there is Mr. Rex Tillerson. He is being nominated for Secretary of State. Again, a very crucial position. As Secretary of State, you are dealing with virtually the entire world, and hence again the concern from the Democrats that the process of the background checks and the report from the Government Ethics Office, that report should be completed before finalizing their nominations. Viewers, there is Betsy, Miss Betsy DeVos. She is being thought of as a nominee for the Education Secretary. Then there is Representative Mike Pompeo, the Director of Central Intelligence. Again, a very important position. Then viewers, there is Mr. Wilbur Ross Jr., who would be nominated as Commerce Secretary. Andrea Pusdar, who would be nominated as Labor Secretary. Tom Price, who would become the nominee for the Health Secretary. And also Mr. Ben Carson, who would be taking the leadership role as the leader of the Housing and Urban Development. So viewers, all these hearings, the Senate would be holding these hearings, you know, in the next week, starting from Tuesday and Wednesday, and it would go on until the next week. And so, the of course, the process says that the checks have to be completed before those nominations they can be finalized. But now, the Republican leaders and Republican analysts, they are saying that there is an exception, and exception can be made on their behalf, because right now the President-elect Donald J. Trump, he does not want to waste time. He has to take certain important and crucial decisions with a very short span of time, and he does not have you know much time on his hands. So if these nominations are confirmed, that time it would be it would not be wasted. And so they would be able to make those important and crucial decisions when, you know, during the time that they need to be taken. Viewers, but Democrats, they are calling for the process to be slowed. Now this seems to be heading towards an altogether different direction. Why they're saying that? Again, because these they have their own set of reservations. Now there is one view. The Republican leaders, they are saying that the Democrats are unhappy with their electoral defeat, and so they are trying to create some problems for the new administration. and this flies in the face of smooth transition promised by President Obama. The Democrats, their view is quite different. The Democratic leadership, they have made it known that number one, they have their reservations against President-elect Donald Trump's rhetoric. For instance, he has been saying certain, you know, harsh, using certain harsh words against Hillary Clinton. President-elect Donald Trump had said that if he would be elected to power during the election campaign, he would see to it that their council is appointed and which would initiate the proceedings against Hillary Clinton, and that she might even end up in jail. This is what he has been saying during the election campaign. And naturally, Democrats feel that this is you know, where the Republicans have struck a raw nerve in them, and they do not want to see the possibility of that nightmare becoming a reality. And so, this is, viewers, this is one reason why they are very much worried. Another reason is the fact that there are a whole set of other policies articulated by President Trump, which the Democrats consider to be not quite good for a section of the American public. For instance, they are very worried that what would happen if the new administration repeals Obamacare, and they have made it very clear that, you know, as Vice President-elect Mike Pence recently said, that this would be the first order of business. One of the first actions of the administration would be to do away with Obamacare. So naturally, they are very much worried. And some of the Democratic leaders, they have been raising their concerns, you know, against the certain torture techniques that President-elect Donald J. Trump articulated, that, and saying that if he would be elected to office, he would restart all those techniques in order to interrogate the terror suspects. So that is where the Democrats need, they want to start, you know, slowing down the process of those nominations from being approved. For instance, viewers, Mr. Jeff Sessions, who would be nominated as the Attorney General, most probably the Democrats are planning to ask him questions about how he would react, or how he what would his behavior be towards any insinuation at you know, starting criminal proceedings against Hillary Clinton. Would he be the Attorney General who would order Hillary Clinton to be taken to jail for her email fiasco? This is something that the Democrats definitely will be asking before they go on and eventually give him the vote for confirmation. They have made it, you know, very public that they would do this. So this is like one challenge that stares in Mr. Jeff Sessions' face that he would have to overcome. Viewers, also Mr. Pompeo, who would be nominated as Director of Central Intelligence, the Democrats plan to ask him questions on certain techniques that President-elect Donald J. Trump said would be restarted after his administration takes office, one of them being waterboarding. So the Democrats would be asking him before they give him the vote of approval, that when he would be the director, would he give approval to those techniques? So that again is a very crucial question, not only for the Democrats but for the Republicans, because this that time of approval, this is a very crucial time. Some analysts are saying that the Republican leaders to get the vote of approval and have the hearings go smoothly, they would try to navigate around those tough questions, and they would rather try to not answer them directly. But again, it sets the stage for a very heated debate. Viewers, on December 21, Democrats in all 16 Senate committees, they released a joint statement saying that they would block confirmations of vote until each nominee receives the FBI background check and completes a financial disclosure statement and ethics and a report from government ethics office. So viewers, if that statement, if that the fact that they have vowed to block the voting and the approvals, if that happens, this is going to cause quite a commotion, and it remains to be seen how that would play out, because definitely there is a conflict of interest involved. Now, what happens is that in certain presidential campaigns in the past, certain presidential candidates, they started the process of the background checks even months before the election itself, so that when they would in the possibility of winning the election, they did not have to lose the time. Viewers, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, he has said that the Democrats need to grow up, referring to their demand for the background checks to be completed before the Senate holds the hearing meeting scheduled for Tuesday and Wednesday, and it would go on into later into the week. He has expressed his concern that the Democrats, they are frustrated at their electoral loss, and this is why they are making this hue and cry. But viewers, being on the other hand, there is Office of Government Ethics Office, and it has its role to play as a government watchdog. There are certain rules that have always been followed, and that sets the stage for democracy to make a very good start. And for that to happen, this due process of law, it should be allowed to take place. The Senator McConnell, he also referred to when they were in the House, and when President Obama, he won the White House, and how they reacted towards his nominations. He said that, how did we react? We approved the nominations on the day that President Obama sworn in. So this is what he is saying, that there is no reason for the Democrats to try to delay the whole process of nominations from becoming confirmed. But that at the end of the day, there are a conflict of interest involved. The ethics report, it has to be completed. The authorities should be given their due time, in which they should look at all the aspects of the the background checks, so that when the individual takes office, there is no needless controversy. And Senator Chuck Schumer, from the United States Senator from New York, he has said that the Democrats, they will try to slow down the hearings until all the background checks they are there. Now there is one perhaps example during President Obama's tenure. That nomination, his background checks, they took a considerable period of time, but the Obama administration, it also delayed the confirmation until the time that those checks arrived. So once those checks were arrived, the Obama administration, it went ahead with confirming the nomination. So viewers, certain administrations, they conduct their own process of initiating background checks. As I've said, Obama administration, it did it. There also happens to be other examples. But in one case, the Republicans are citing certain examples from the past, and the Democrats, they are denying that. But whatever will happen, of course, as President-elect Donald J. Trump has said, that he does not want to waste time. He wants the work to be started and initiated as soon as possible, and those members of his cabinet, they are going to play a very crucial role in helping him fulfill his promises and initiating the new administration from doing its work. And so he needs to have those nominations confirmed without any delay. But viewers, this again, this difference of opinion, this is the beauty of democracy, where it does not matter if you happen to be in power or if you are not in power, your opinion, your whatever your views are, they are respected. And naturally, this debate is going on in a very positive manner, and hopefully it would bode well for democracy, and also it would do something positive for the new administration to make a good start. Viewers, with that, we'll take a very short break. Don't go anywhere. We'll be just right back. Welcome back, viewers. We now move on to our final segment. News is coming in that the attacker in Fort Lauderdale, Hollywood International Airport in Florida, his problems multiplied shortly before he went on rampage and took lives of so many innocent civilians. How his problems multiplied, viewers, recently his family told the authorities that he lost his mind in Iraq. In the time in Iraq when he was deployed, that was a time of intense fighting. Brutal fighting was going on. Two of his fellow soldiers, they were killed. And according to his family members, he had seen terrible things in the war. And other family members report that when he came back, it seemed as if he had lost. He had been lost. He had problems interacting with family and friends, and he became even more shy and more reserved, although he did not express any extremist views, but he was a completely different person, as if he had retreated into the deepest and darkest recesses of his thought process. Viewers, now, as of now, the investigations are going on, and it is being said the different departments are cooperating, but view is emerging that right now there is absolutely no motive as of now, but nothing has been ruled out because it's an ongoing process and it's going to take time. More than 180 people have been interviewed, and the law enforcement, they are looking for a possible motive, but he is very soon he would be charged and he would be brought to justice. But viewers, at the end of the day, it also raises the question of mental health issues that the individuals are facing, and they are not brought to the notice where it should be brought, and some kind of treatment should be given to the individual. That is not being done, it seems, apparently. What else is a problem of concern is that guns, more and more guns are ending up in the hands of mentally disturbed individuals. And then one day it happens, the news breaks out that, that mentally challenged individual, he was seen going out and venting out his frustration and his demons onto other people. And he had, so many weapons. So news events of, this kind, they are becoming more frequent, and it raises a concern that something needs to be done to prevent such individuals from having access to guns. Now another report is coming in that his girlfriend, around December, she reported to the authorities that he had he lashed out at her, and he tried to break the door of the bathroom when she was inside, and he became even more angry, and he tried screaming, and he ultimately broke down the door, and then she called the cops, the police came, and so he attracted the attention of the authorities, and later he also attracted the police attention when there was another incident of domestic violence. He was getting violent. He was getting unnerved with his family. But at the end of the day, there was this pattern emerging that he was onto something, that you know, he the guns that he had at his disposal, they were like a ticking time bomb, and eventually it resulted in a tragedy. Viewers, as you know, 5 people have been killed, more than around 8 have been injured, and they are fighting for their lives. And while we pray for them, debate is going on how to do something, perhaps a kind of a legislation to prevent the proliferation of guns in society. Viewers, there is also news. It's not actually news. It's research. Data has come up that many of the, in fact, most of the attackers, the terrorists and other attackers, they got their guns legally. They underwent all the background checks, and they received the ammunitions and firearms following the due process of law. Now, Umar Mateen, the attacker who you know, shot 50 people to death in Orlando, he purchased the firearms by following the due procedure of law. The background checks were done, and it was like he was regarded as not a threat, and so he was able to get the guns. In another incident in San Bernardino in California, Muhammad Farooq, he also got the guns through the legal process, but nobody knew at that time that, you know, this would result into this much carnage and destruction and loss of life. So viewers, it is at this point, at this particular juncture, that the that there you know, there is need to do something. Perhaps there is also view that an individual, when they step into a store and purchase a gun, they are perfectly all right, they are in full possession of their mental faculties. But what happens if they get all the guns and all the weapons and all the ammunitions, but later on they lose, they become you know, psychiatric patients, and so there is no program in place to get the guns back from such individuals. If your record is not good, you have the guns in your possession, even though you have acquired them through legal means, but it seems that you are having trouble with law, you are having you know, problems with you are being attracted to authorities through calls of domestic violence, and you are displaying a pattern of behavior that shows that this is not normal. Something needs to be done, you know, to get the guns back from those dangerous hands. Viewers, as you know, gun violence has been on the rise in the U.S., particularly in recent years. But you know, the mass shootings themselves, they result in you know, in severe and massive loss of life. But not only mass shootings, there are other incidents such as suicides, gang violence, drug related violence, street crime, and at the end of the day, it is the gun proliferation, the you know, these massive proliferation of guns, that the fact that you can step into a store and grab a gun and you know, and you know, whatever money that you have to pay for, but your intentions, how you would you know, behave when you have gun under your belt, and you are not, there is a due process, like the for instance, the personnel of the law enforcement, they go through rigorous training, discipline, and they are a different breed of individuals. But of course, even at the end of the day, in this case, this person who went out and killed 5 people, he was an Iraqi war veteran. This is even more alarming, that if you have been like used to using the guns for a very long time, you are even more prone to resorting to violence. So viewers, at the end of the day, there is dire need for certain mechanism to be put in place to keep a check on individuals, particularly those individuals who display a certain kind, set pattern of behavior, and it becomes relatively easy to trace and detect the dangers that might lie ahead. Viewers, with that, we'll be ending tonight's show. And thank you very much for watching. This is Janis R. Ahmed from Millennium TV USA. Until the next show, goodbye.